Thank you all for coming out. We're very lucky today. I'm Andy, part of the privacy team, and as part of Privacy and Security Week, I was inviting up a few friends to give a talk, and one of them happened to be Nita, who very graciously said, hey, why don't we do an extra clinic and just come and talk about music as long as we're here. So that's awesome. And I'm thinking most of you know who she is by now, but if you don't, this person has been part of the Iron Maidens, is currently touring with Alice Cooper. You would have seen her on Jimmy Kimmel if you stayed up too late last night. It was really an awesome show.
I stayed up too late, but I didn't see it.
Yeah. So, yeah, everyone, Nita Strauss.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm really, really, really happy to be back here at Google. And I'll say it again for the live stream. I really came up for the pizza bar. but I am so excited to be back here and be a part of Privacy Week. And Andy's absolutely right. As soon as he said, do you want to come back up here and do this? And I thought pizza, and I said yes. The second thing I thought was, what else can I bring to you guys that will maybe just get to, you know, show? Because every time I come here, I get a glimpse into a little bit of a different side of life than what I do. So I thought maybe I could share a little bit of what I do with you guys as well. And like I said before, I don't really want to follow my traditional clinic format, you know, where I'll play and tell the same kind of stories. Like, I want this to be about you guys and about your interaction, your experience with music and your questions. So I want to spend this hour really just chatting about stuff and trying to give you whatever insight I can.
Yeah, and we will have somebody walking around with a microphone as well.
Bam!
Yep. So please raise your hands, you know, flag him down and he'll come over. But for now, you've been on the road now.
Forever.
First time you came by was over 2.5, almost 3 years ago.
Yeah, that's right.
Touring with Alice. So you've been on the road constantly since then. Yeah, have you had any fun road stories from Alice?
Let's see, with Alice specifically, the funnest story, I think, you know, because our band, I hate to say it like this, but our band is so pro, you know, we don't really, like, I don't drink, because, you know, most of the other guys in the band, if they drink, they don't get drunk, nobody does drugs, it's like, it's a very pro, you know, situation, so there's not really a lot of really funny stories, like, it's like, well, yeah, we, you know, our bus leaves right after the show every night, we don't, you know, hang out or do anything.
Yeah.
I go to sleep probably earlier than most of you guys do on the road every night. But Alice did say to me my first day in the band, he said, I'm going to tell you three things. You're going to see the world, you're going to get paid, and you're going to get stitches. And every single one of those things, I haven't, like, literally gotten stitches, but I've injured myself on stage so many times. Actually, I fell down at the Warfield. Did you see?
I didn't notice.
Yeah, I fell down, which resulted in them carpeting our entire stage from now on.
Wait, is that going to help or hurt?
It helps because it's the bubbles.
But no running across doing knee slides
while
playing.
Oh, I do that kind of, you know, the knee slide was unintentional, let's say. no, we have these, they call them the evil bubbles at the end of our show. I don't know what makes them evil. Because it's a bubble machine.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, I mean, they're not funny color or anything. It's bubbles. But I found out, I guess, what makes them evil, because it makes the floor really slippery. And after the second time I fell, Alice himself actually at the Warfield put the kibosh on the bubbles unless we got the whole stage carpeted. So now, thanks to me, we basically have like the safety scissors version of the stage. you can't really mess it up. Like, you have to really fall down. Like, and I'll just kind of like segue into whatever I
yeah.
think of, which is, I guess, what I do best. It's like playing guitar. It's like improvisation.
Absolutely.
But, you know, I think...
You think I prepared?
Yeah. How do you prepare for that?
No.
But really, I think it's so important to do stuff like run around and fall down on stage. And it's important to run around and fall down in any aspect of what you're doing. You know, if what you're doing is your passion, if what you're doing is your goal in life, it's important to run across the stage and fall down a couple times. You know what I mean? It's important to take that risk. I had somebody ask me, I put up some GoPro videos. I've been putting the GoPro here on my guitar, which I just noticed has a little scuff on it from that now. Don't like that at all. I had somebody ask me, don't you worry that you're gonna make a mistake when you're running around like that, throwing the guitar all around, playing behind your head, and doing all this stuff. And I thought about it, and it literally never occurred to me to worry that I might make a mistake. Of course I'm gonna make a mistake. You see what I do? You're playing the guitar upside down, doing all this stuff like this. Like, you're not gonna hit every note. But that's kind of like what makes it what it is. If you wanna see somebody hit every note, go listen to the record. You know, if you want to hit everything on the head and play it safe all the time, there's no way to advance to where you want to be. So I think it's important to play upside down and miss that note and break a string and run across the stage and fall on your butt like a dummy like I did at the Warfield like 4 days ago, like right in front of you two guys.
Oh, yeah. We actually do have a very similar philosophy here, too.
Really?
You know, we encourage failing frequently, you know, fail often, because if you don't fail, you're not trying something.
I just dropped my guitar pick as I was saying that.
Like, oh, perfect.
It's perfect. No, you don't have to get it. Like, that's not what I was saying.
It's okay.
But thank you. And we
just all right.
Fail multiple times. Yeah, I remember hearing about, I know that we're talking to a Google audience, but I'd love it if you could elaborate on that for me a little bit.
Well, really, you know, it's just a lot of that experimental, you know, we like people to go off and work on their own projects, something that excites them, that, you know, isn't their day job. And they're going to come up with something interesting, and it may succeed, it may not, and if it succeeds, great, it turns into something huge. If it doesn't,
yeah.
So what? You tried something.
You did it, and it sucked.
You probably learned something from it.
And you will find a lesson in any of it.
Yeah.
Whether the lesson is that somebody needs to put more carpet, or the lesson is that you need to change something in the way that you're doing things, and there always is that lesson to be learned. And I think the same goes for, you know, I think there's a lot of parallels between, you know, if you can find the parallels in any aspect of life, any aspect of your career. When I was when I joined Alice Cooper, I wasn't really what you'd call, you know, your typical rock guitar player. I didn't take lessons. I didn't, you know, play. I played in a lot of bands, but there were so many like stepping stones on the course to being a rock player that I totally missed. Because I was self-taught, and I listened to, you know, these shred guys. I listened to Jason Becker, who's, you know, from here, and listened to Steve Vai and Satriani and Paul Gilbert and Marty Friedman, and like, I never heard them do any of that blues stuff. I mean, Yngwie did, but nobody listens to it. So, like, no, seriously, I ask this a lot of my clinics. Show of hands, does anybody own that Yngwie blues album?
There's an Yngwie blues album?
He has done blues stuff, and I know this for a fact, but I've never listened to it. And you guys are all Malmsteen fans for the most part, and you guys have never listened to it. So it's like, so it's funny, you know, like, so when I joined the Alice Cooper band, I went through an audition process of, it was a video audition. You know, I got recommended to them by the most, probably the last person that anyone would ever think of. It was Kip Winger from the band Winger. That called them up and said, I have somebody for you to check out. Not many people know this, but Kip actually used to play bass for Alice in, I think, 89 to 91, I want to say. I could be wrong on the dates. But he's still really in good with the, you know, with their camp. And I think actually the person he texted, I think, was Alice's wife, Cheryl. And he said, I know you're looking for a female guitar player. I have her. I have who you want. And from there, I met Shep Gordon, his manager, and Bob Ezrin. And if you guys haven't seen the movie Supermensch about Shep, it's a great, great movie. It's a great documentary about his life. A lot of tall tales, I'm sure, but a good, entertaining documentary. So I met Shep and Bob, and we really hit it off. And then I went through this process of video auditions for them. And The first audition I did, they sent me two songs to play over with no guitar, and I pulled out all the stops. Like, every crazy trick I know, like, every, you know, just technique stuff I don't even know how to do anymore because I've been now playing the rock stuff for 3 years. I haven't even practiced any of this technique stuff. Excuse me. And, you know, playing upside down, doing all this crazy stuff. And then I did two videos, which were about 5 minutes each, so it should have taken them, in theory, 10 minutes to watch the whole thing. And Bob Ezrin called me like about a minute and a half after I pressed send. And he said, this is not what we want at all. this isn't it. You know, do you know what band you're auditioning for? I was like, no, I know. Like, now I see what you want. Like, okay, hold on, let me do it again. So I went through it twice more. And at the end he said, Alice needs a rock guitar player. Can you become a rock guitar player in time? Which was about 2.5 weeks before the start of the Motley Crue tour. And I said, absolutely. Absolutely, I can. And he said, well, you answered that really quickly. He called me on the phone and woke me up. And he said, can you become a rock guitar player in time? And I said, yes. And he said, will you answer that really quickly? And I said, well, I know I can do it. He said, okay. And then he hung up on me. And then I called around in LA and I found a guitar teacher. And I said, dude, please, like, I need some licks, like, help your girl out. So I went and I sat down with this teacher for the first time, and I realized there's so much to be learned by just doing it yourself, by just teaching yourself what it is that you want to know. But there's also so much that can be learned by just going to someone that knows more and saying, hey, what can I do better? It's not necessarily to go to someone and say, I need my whole plan laid out, how I'm going to learn how to play from A, B to, you know, all the way down, whatever the end is. But it's never bad to go to someone and say, how can I improve this? So, for example, you guys are mostly guitar players in here? Mostly, yes? No, maybe not. I don't know.
A handful of us.
Some guitar players, some non-guitar players. But there's the guitar players in here will be familiar with the pentatonic scale, right? So we've got... Right? Simple, easy. I never knew you could put this extra note. I was like, wait. So I was always going. I was like, what is this note in here? I was like, how come nobody told me that you can do that? And the reason is because I never asked. I never went to anybody and said, what are the stepping stones? Like, what are the building blocks? So, I mean, this is I'm kind of going back to my usual clinic stories here, and I'm trying to stay away from those. But I will say, you know, something that I feel strongly about that I try to impress on all my clinics is never be too proud to go to somebody that knows more and say, what could I be doing better? How can I improve this? Because then I use that lick all the time. I use that extra note all the time, and I can only imagine what I would have done with it if I would have known about it like 15 years ago. that's something I think is really important. Yes?
So, two-part question.
All right.
Oh, wait, microphone coming.
Oh, sorry. Fancy.
We have lots of people on the live stream, hopefully.
Okay, two-part question. Kay. First, as a music fan, in all of your travels and tours and stuff, have you had like a big starstruck moment where you've met somebody that just really, you know, you got starstruck? Who was it and how did that experience go?
Totally. Should I answer one at a time?
Yeah.
Okay, Vi. It was Vi. And I talk about Vi all the time. You know, everybody knows that I started, you know, for those that don't know, I started playing guitar after seeing the movie Crossroads. And you know, the scene at the end, I'm not going to spoil it for people that haven't seen it, but there's this scene at the end that will make you go play guitar if you don't play guitar already. And I talk about Vi as my biggest influence all the time. And I had never met him until last year. Or is it? No, earlier this year. Earlier this year, I went to Generation Axe, which was, again, totally life-changing. I almost came up here to see it a second time. Afterward, my boyfriend Josh and I were hanging out with some of our Ibanez guys, and we didn't have the right passes, and they were trying to get us to leave, and I was like, let's just go. He's not coming out. and he wouldn't let me leave. Josh would not let me leave. He said, no, you are going to meet Steve Vai tonight. And I didn't want to stay, and I felt stupid because we didn't have the right pass, and like I don't like when someone asks me to leave and I don't leave. Like I just felt uncomfortable. And then somebody said, no, he's coming up to get us right now. And who did come up to get us out into the audience area, but actual Steve Vai. Came up super tall, wearing a fishnet shirt. and I introduced myself, you know, and I was like so shy, like I don't even know what I said. But I said, I'm Nita, I said, I'm Steve. And then I was kind of like, oh, he didn't know who I was, kind of like a little bummed. And then he turned around, he said, you're the guitar player. He's like, I've seen your stuff. And then he started saying the nicest stuff. He said, wow, I've seen videos of you really doing great out there. How's Alice? And like, so that was really like a pinnacle, huge moment for me. Like I had sort of hoped that he would maybe recognize my name, you know, being an Ibanez player and having started to make a name for myself in the music scene. But to see that he actually had heard, sorry, I'm so tired. He had actually heard my playing and seen videos and was familiar. He said he liked my version of the national anthem, which I used to do at the LA Kiss games. And to find out that he had seen that and heard that was, I can't describe that feeling. I really, really, really can't describe that feeling. And then he took me aside and said he was putting together a compilation album of female guitar players for his label, Favored Nations, and asked me to be a part of it, which is now coming out in January. It's my first instrumental song ever to come out. Josh played drums on it, so I have, there he is. He's in the back, he's always working. But it's my first instrumental song, and I'm just so grateful to get to do it on a label like Vi's.
And that one is called She Rocks?
She Rocks, yes. Okay. She Rocks, curated by Brad Tulinski, who was the editor-in-chief of Guitar World, I think, for 25 years. And Brad, Steve, and Laura Whitmore from Guitar World put this all together. And it's myself, Orianthi, Jennifer Batten, Lita is on it, and then a couple up-and-coming guitar players, Yossi Hofer, Neely Brosh, Yvette Young. Like, it's like a who's who of Brad female guitar players. And when I was young, growing up, I know I'm totally rambling on your question, but I'm going to keep doing that. Because I'm up here and I can't.
That's why we're here.
Yeah. When I was young, I didn't have any female guitar players to look up to. I didn't know who Jennifer was until way later. And I didn't, so it never occurred to me to seek out a female role model, you know, and I get asked a lot. Again, I'm trying to stay away from my clinic stuff, but I fall into this and it's important, so I'm gonna keep going with it. I get asked a lot, who were your favorite guitar players growing up? Was it, you know, Hart and Joan Jett and Lita Ford? And I thought, no, my favorite guitar player was Marty Friedman. Like, you know, my favorite guitar players were Jason Becker and Vi. And it never was a thing for me that I had to find a girl to look up to. And then I saw Jennifer playing with Michael Jackson at the Super Bowl, and I was like, this is so cool, she's doing it. And the band Phantom Blue, two great female guitar players. Michelle Meldrum was an amazing player. But those were kind of the only two I knew of until pretty recently. And now it's so cool to be a part of this surge of incredible female musicians. I never really try to categorize myself as a female guitar player, but it is what I am. So it's cool to be a part of what's going on now. And I have to apologize for coughing so much too, because last night was Halloween. I don't know when this is gonna re-air, but right now it's November 1st, and I went to Halloween Horror Nights last night, and I was screaming my head off for the better part of 3 hours. So.
And then slept for like 2 hours and got on a plane here, so thank
yeah,
you
we're
so
coming
much
off
for coming.
Four shows in a row. Actually, I haven't had a day off since I saw you guys at the Warfield. We've had four shows in a row. We did Jimmy Kimmel last night, and then we went to Halloween Horror Nights. We dressed up as Macho Man and Miss Elizabeth. And to walk around in high heels all night, which is not something I normally do. And then got home at 3, got back up at 5, and got on the plane and came up here. So I'm going to keep coughing, and I'm sorry. But totally worth it because Halloween Horror Nights was really scary and really fun. You said there was a second part to your question.
Yeah, but...
Oh.
I know, I was like, I saw it going away and I was That's still okay. talking.
Yeah, then my other question is guitar geek question.
Go. So I love it.
Is there a piece of gear that maybe sold off or traded away at some point and wish that you hadn't done that and could get it back?
That's a great question. And I'll tell you exactly which one it is, and it's not going to be what you'd ever think. So my first, this is not my first guitar. I started teaching guitar lessons in high school. And I wasn't really any good then, but I had kids, students who were really not good, so it was fine. and I saved up every single penny of the money I had, because my guitar back then was I had a Squire. My first guitar was a Squire, like everybody's first guitar. It was $99, and it came with an amp and a cable, like, you know, a little tiny amp and a cable and like some picks and a capo and like just some mishmash of stuff, right? So I wanted a cooler guitar. So I would always just go into Sam Ash and just sit there and play these guitars. And I saw this PC Rich. Guitar players are laughing because they're going, what? So this see-through, it was the acrylic platinum, BC Rich Warlock, cherry red. And I'll go, man, they are so cool. Like, so, you know, I'm teaching these guitar lessons, making $20 an hour or something. And I just saved every little bit of it together for like a year. And I got this guitar. I bought this BC Rich acrylic platinum, and I had sat at Guitar Center and played it through their amps and stuff. What I didn't do ever was stand up and play it. That thing weighs 13 and a half pounds. And to put that in perspective, this is my main stage guitar. This thing weighs 3.5 or 4 pounds. I mean, like, the thing, it was massive. You think a Les Paul is heavy. A Les Paul is 8.5 pounds, I think. You know, this BC Rich was so heavy. I played it at one show only, and then I traded it for $500 for my first car. So I was 16 at the time, and so I traded that guitar and $500 for my first car. But that is the only guitar I've ever sold. I've kept all my other ones because I'm a hoarder. I'm a gear hoarder. You should see our studio is just like piled high with, you know, cases and amps and this and that. So if I had to pick one, since that's the only one I've ever gotten rid of, I'd say I guess that one, because then the collection would be complete. but I would never play it, because the thing for those who don't know, and without getting too technical about it, it's made out of plexiglass, this thing. So it sounds terrible. I mean, this is made out of mahogany. You know, like, you need something that'll resonate. It doesn't resonate at all. Plexiglass doesn't have any depth to it, any body to it. So the thing sounds terrible, played terrible, it's heavy. I would never play it. I just would have it because I'd have it, because I'd have all my guitars. So, yeah. Awesome. Yes?
As you've learned over time, have you hit plateaus? And if you have, how do you get past them?
Big time. Big time. I've hit plateaus bigly. the best thing I can say, I'm actually sort of in one right now as we speak. I touched on it briefly before, but I'm a shred kid at heart. Like, I've always been into the fast stuff. And I love playing with Alice Cooper. Like, I love being on stage with Coop every night, and the band is great, and the songs are great, and the fans are great. But I find my technique going backwards, because I'm sort of in this easy situation where I don't have to play anything hard, like, you know, and your technique will fall by the wayside, you know, if you're not using it. You have to keep up on it. And I actually have a repetitive stress injury in my left hand, which comes from not stretching properly, which we'll talk about as well. So that limits the amount of time I can play guitar in a day. And so my guitar time has to be my show time. Basically, I can't play for, it starts to get painful around 2 hours. Our show is 100 minutes, so with warm-up time and like a little, you know, here and there, when I'm on tour, I don't play guitar much when I'm not on stage, because I have to take care of, this is how I eat, you know? I think the main thing that you really have to do, and this goes with anything, is to keep falling in love with your instrument. Keep falling in love with what it is that made you love it in the first place. So for me, we just finished out the end of this long, long tour literally yesterday. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go home and sleep for a few days. And then what my big plan is I'm gonna finish learning Perpetual Burn. Because I learned the first half of it last year, and I never did finish learning it. And that's something I feel like I need to do to fall back in love with this instrument and start remember why I started playing in the first place. I think improvisation is also key. You want to keep yourself fresh. You know, playing the same songs over and over and over again, playing them the same way. So I've been on tour playing the same songs for the last 3 years. It can get you stuck in a rut. So I think improvising over songs that aren't your normal songs, and you know, I have my go-to ones, which I'll totally share with you guys. It's Heaven by Bryan Adams and Alone by Heart. And you can laugh all you want, but those songs are so fun to improvise over. Like, I know I'm supposed to be metal, but like, those songs are so fun to improvise over. Because they just take you, they're real easy chords, big easy chords, you know, even a Bon Jovi song or, you know, anything with just big, slow moving, easy chords that'll just let you switch the brain off and just let your hands, it's gonna sound cheesy, but your hands and your heart, that's where the tone comes from, that's where the playing comes from. You just have to learn how to switch. Nothing helpful comes from in here when you're playing. That all has to be done during practice time. So when you're really up there, like, you know, performing or improvising or whatever it is, this has to go. Anything in here has to go. There's nothing good in there. It has to go. So just switch it off and let your hands do what they know how to do. That's my best advice.
What's it like, both parts and in terms of the technology, like the pedal boards and so forth, arranging for three guitars with Alice, especially on a lot of tunes that are written for two? Do you guys try to like sit in different spots in the EQ space? How do you think about the solo patches, etc.?
I love this question so much, and all the non-guitar players in here are going, oh, God. But I love this question. And it's definitely a very well-constructed wall of sound that we have on stage with three guitar players. It's myself, Ryan Roxy, and Tommy Henriksen. And we're all actually using Marshalls now, which makes it very cohesive sounding. Ryan's on a JCM 900, Tommy's on an 800, and I'm using a JVM. So it's a very cohesive sound. You have a JVM too? So good. yeah, I just got mine. I love mine. But it's definitely a different, you have to sit at different spots in the EQ space, and you also have to sit at different spots on the fretboard. Because if you have three guitar players at the same time all playing the same chord, it's just gonna sound muddy, unless everyone is hitting it precisely at the same moment, which is not possible, and it's just gonna sound muddy. So really, you know, usually let's take an E chord, since that's what I just said. So if we're doing an E chord, this chair has a lot of stuff up here. If we're doing an E chord, usually I'll play it, or someone, you know, let's say someone plays here, someone will be here, and then usually the third person will hit the octave. But that kind of gives it that more open feeling, rather than just all of us bashing away on that open power chord. If you have one person playing the single note or the octave, that gives it much more of a cohesive sound, and it makes it just makes everything more polished. Something that a lot of people don't know about our band, it's pretty unique in the spectrum of bands that are touring and doing stuff now, is we don't use any tracks. We don't use any backing tracks, which most bands do just for, like, you know, harmonies and, you know, this extra stuff. The only stuff that we have on the backing tracks is like samples, stuff that we can't do, like thunder and lightning and rain, you know, unless I guess we get one of those like rain stick things or something. We don't have one mic'd up yet. So we have stuff like that, you know, like the rain sample and the bell for School's Out, you know, we have that kind of stuff. But there's not even a click track going on during our shows. So that's another thing that helps our bands stay really current sounding with the bands that are out there, you know, layering extra guitars and extra rhythm tracks and this and that to make it sound fuller. Our band just does it all live on the fly. So that's another thing that makes it pretty unique, I think.
A lot of planning, yep. Then, I'm sure, going into it.
It is a lot of planning. It is a lot of planning. It's very, like I said, carefully constructed. And a big part of it, too, is this works, you know, this goes for two guitar player bands as well, but especially for three guitar player bands, you cannot make a lot of extra noise, which is key. And like, you know, if you're doing, let's take the Billion Dollar Babies riff, you know. You know, you don't want to be. That's how I would do it if I was the only one up there. But when there's three guitar players doing it, it has to be that very crisp cutoff, you know, no, not even any extra delay or anything on the rhythm sound, because everybody's got to have, I do it too when I'm the only one up there, because it sounds better. I got all this delay on here now because I'm the only one here. But when there's multiple guitar players out there, we played in LA. We did Kimmel last night, and we did a hometown show for me at the Pantages Theater the night before that. And for 18 Schools Out, we had five guitar players on stage. Because it was us three, and then we had Butch Walker up there, who outplayed everybody. And actually, Johnny Depp got up and played with us as well, which was really cool. And nobody told him about the extra string noise. Yeah, he was great, so great. But nobody told him not to make extra noise. So it's, you know, especially in any kind of multiple guitar situation, it's so really so important, you know, roll off that volume knob at quiet parts, you know, don't do the extra pick slides, which I'm, and the extra pinch harmonics, all that stuff, which I'm so, so guilty of. It's not even funny. Like, but it's important. It's really, really important. So that's also a good piece of advice, I think.
Now, you mentioned that you only had like 2 or 3 weeks before you, when you got the call.
That's right.
To join the band and go on tour.
26 songs.
Did you actually have to go in, were these arranged already? Did you guys sit down to work it out between the three of you?
It was arranged. It was, you know, I jumped right into Orianthi's parts.
Okay.
So it was actually so easy. It was so, so, so easy. What I did was I asked them for a board mix of the show with her guitar really loud. Because as any of you guys that have seen us in the past, you know, 5 years, I would say, as you guys know, the way that we do the songs now is arranged for the instruments very differently than the original. We play I shouldn't say it's arranged differently, it's played differently. The arrangement's exactly the same. We keep it very true to the original feel and the original vibe of the songs. But if you just go to the record and listen to it, you're not gonna hear these extra nuances, like I'm saying, of the one person doing the octave versus these. So you need to hear what those nuances are in the current show. So what I did was I asked for a board mix from the show with Ori's guitar really loud in it. And then I asked them a week later for a board mix with her guitar completely out so I could make sure I wasn't following it too much. Because that is the worst when you're playing, you know, when you're playing along to a song and you're playing along to the CD and you're like nailing it completely, and then you try to play without the CD and you're like, oh, it's not at all how it sounded to me before. So I wanted to make sure I wasn't doing that. But then I really familiarized myself with the whole entity of the song and not just the part that I was supposed to be learning, because I think it's so important as a hired musician, and again, I think this is something that can translate into a lot of different fields, but I think it's so important to really keep in mind what the overall vibe of what you're doing is. You know, you don't want to just cruise in there. If I had just cruised in and said, look, I'm a shredder, this is what I do, I would already be on a plane home. You have to be mindful of what the overall objective is and take yourself out of the equation a little bit. And really just focus on the overall objective. Distracted. But I think that's one of the most important things as an artist to realize, is when to put yourself and your ego in the back seat and really focus on. Actually, that's what this shirt that I've been wearing for the last week of this tour and haven't washed yet says, ego kills talent. Because I think it's one of my favorite shirts that I own, because I think it's something so important to remember that no matter how huge your talent is, your ego can always get in the way and destroy everything. So it's very, very, very important. I hope that rambling answer made sense. Next question, anybody?
So another technique geek question.
Yeah.
Understandably, shredding especially, a lot of, you know, repeating the same exercise over and over and over again. How do you stay focused, you know, from beats per minute of 72 all the way up to 144, you know, mental focus? How do you maintain it? And
you're talking about like speed training?
Yeah, yeah. Stuff? How do you maintain focus while you're training your fingers?
You know what? I'm not going to tell anybody that this is what you should do because it's probably not. I don't focus at all, even a little bit. I watch TV. I watch TV while I do it because I really, first of all, I get bored really easily.
That's the problem.
Yeah, it is the problem. Absolutely. I'm totally with you on that. But I find that the mental part of it is not as important for me. The mental part of being there. And again, I probably shouldn't recommend this because it's not something that probably would work for everybody. But for me, the important thing is the clarity of the notes and the speed of the metronome. So I'll start the metronome at a ridiculously, you know, which is what I'm going to have to do next week when I go back to the Becker stuff. You start the metronome at 60, like it's just something unbearably slow. And it has to be so slow, as you know, that you can't possibly mess it up. And for me, I do it 5 times perfectly at that speed. And then I move the metronome up 5 beats per minute at a time. So 60, 65, 70, 75, so on and so forth. I know people that do it in smaller increments. But again, I have a short attention span. And the real key for me when speed training is to never let yourself get away with a sloppy rep. You know what I mean? Because it's really easy when you're the only, and by the way, if you guys are ever gonna do this, never do it around anyone else because it's humiliating. Because you cannot do it 5 times perfectly, no matter how slow it is, at any speed, like every single time. So don't ever do it around your band. Don't ever do it around another guitar player. Like this is your home practice headphones thing. Like, but don't let yourself get away with a sloppy rep because it's easy to say that one was good enough. Like the only person you're hurting is yourself when you do that. So really just focus on making each one perfect. And I wouldn't recommend putting on something that you're really interested in on the TV. Like, you know, you don't want to really follow, like, you know, like a, you don't want to be doing Game of Thrones or something where you have to pay attention. I usually will just put on something I've seen before, you know, and just really let my mind shut off, you know, do something else with my head and just let my fingers do what they need to do, which is the muscle memory. I hope that helps. It's probably the opposite of the answer you were looking for.
Well, yeah, I was thinking, oh,
here's what this, I know, no, dude, I wish. Like, do you have any, do you have any tips? Because I probably need some.
No, that's why I'm asking you.
No, I'll probably, like, when I get, I like that show Shark Tank. Like, so I'll probably go home next week and just put on old episodes of Shark Tank and just drill some of these patterns.
As surprising as it is, you know, that when I was in music school, that was actually, I improved as soon as I bought a TV.
Really?
Because, yeah, I could sit there and mindlessly watch an episode of The Simpsons and play along.
Oh, totally.
You know, instead of, you know, having the radio on or something, or trying to focus too much on what I was doing.
Exactly.
So, yeah, it's not just you.
Exactly. Okay, good.
It's also an easy way to blow through half an hour. If you're staring at your fingers for 30 minutes, practice.
Totally. Yeah. Well, exactly. It is. It makes it a lot easier to sit there and just play. And again, and the improvisation will help too. It doesn't really help with the metronome part, but that will help if you're just trying to get X amount of practice time in. Sometimes you can just put on an album and just improvise over the album. Just something with a lot of melody to it. You know, improvisation over Metallica songs, as much as I love Metallica and can't wait, November 18th, new Metallica, so excited. It's not easy to improvise over. That doesn't let you switch the brain off because you're going, okay, here we go, so fast. Like, you really, like, it has to be something easy. Like, just Heaven by Bryan Adams. Just try it one time, and I'm telling you. It's eye-opening to do something like that because it really will. And that half hour will fly by. If you play Heaven by Bryan Adams 6 times, it'll be easy. Yes, I see the microphone there.
Yeah, thanks for being here, first of all. You touched on the importance of stretching. I was wondering, what is your warm-up routine?
Thank you very much for
You're
asking.
Welcome.
This is one of my most important things that I try to impress on all guitar players. And actually, most of you guys probably work with computers, I'm guessing. So this is probably, you guys probably have carpal tunnel dilemmas as much as guitar players do. The same kind of thing. So the importance of stretching is, I literally can't stress it enough, and because I didn't know it, I literally can't play the way that I probably could if I had, you know, the amount of practice I'd like to. So I think the most important thing is, a big mistake that guitar players make is thinking that the stretching is all in the fingers. Because yes, it's important, but this is actually the least of your worries. What you need to stretch is the tendon that goes all the way here. So I'll ask you guys to do it with me because it's important. Put your hand straight out in front of you, like stop, and turn it upside down. There you go. You feel it a little bit here. Now put your hand to the side. I know some of you are gonna run into each other a little bit. And turn your head all the way away from, no, the side, not the front, side. There you go. And you'll feel the stretch from the tips of your fingers all the way into your shoulder, and that's where you need that stretch. So rotate your hand around. We're doing yoga together. This is fun. And then turn your head away, and you'll feel that stretch even more right here. And that's where you're gonna get injured. I wish you guys could see our view right now.
It's pretty entertaining.
But that is actually what I do before every show, no matter what. No matter what, no matter what, if I don't have time, because sometimes I won't have time to warm up properly the way I'd like to. But that is one thing that I do without fail for every show. And it takes, you know, 30 seconds to just do a quick, and I'm looking at the monitor now that was close to my head. Stop! But it takes a minute, 2 minutes at the most, and it will make such a huge, huge difference. So everybody that plays guitar watching this, I'm gonna talk to this camera, I'm being serious, definitely make sure you're stretching carefully before you are playing for any length of time, because it will make a big difference. I hope that helps. Anybody else? Yes?
So can you talk a little bit about your creative process, like when you're trying to create a new song? Try to shoot for an emotion or a subject or
Yeah, definitely. I think for me, the creative process for the last several years as a hired gun guitar player has been it's all about the solos. It's been because I haven't until recently been composing music. I just actually recently in the past year decided that I wanted to do a band and start composing music with, you know, with my own band again. So I've gotten back into doing that. But the solos for me have been where I've been able to shine, you know, the guest solos and, you know, other albums or video games or whatever it is I'm playing on. And the first thing I always ask is, what is the song about? Because I think the guitar solo is the guitar player's chance to add a piece of the story. You know, and if you're just going, okay, the song's in D, I'm gonna do some licks in D and that's my solo. It doesn't really, you can tell when that's the process. You can tell, okay, this song is about this heartbreak, this song's about, you know, whatever it is, this lost love or whatever it is, and then the guitar player is just doing these licks in D that don't have any meaning to the song. I feel like I can tell. And I think you guys, I see some people nodding, I think you can tell too. Like, when there's not a lot of thought that goes into the solo process. So I think really I would say the paramount thing for that is just to be mindful. Like, you know, like I said, like I was saying before, be mindful of the overall objective and think about the song. Think about the song when you're playing it. I actually burst into tears at one of my clinics in Canada last year because I was thinking about what the song meant to me, and I was pouring this emotion into the song, and it was perfect because I had just talked about this in the clinic. But I actually just started bawling on stage in front of 300 people because I was like, this is what this song means to me. This is, you know, it was the song Poison, which this lyrically, I wasn't crying because of the lyrics of that song. Those lyrics are silly. But I played in a cover band. I played in a couple cover bands, but I played in this 80s cover band when I was 18 or 19. I was like Steel Panther, but like not very funny. and with no people at our shows. But I played in this 80s cover band, and we played every Saturday night at this little tiny bar that I wasn't even old enough to get into, you know, way out, you know, 45 minutes from my house, like way out in this random place, you know, 45 minutes from LA. And we would play Poison in this band. And I just think back to my first time playing it on stage with Alice and how that felt to get from this tiny little bar where we were just hoping, you know, we were playing for $100 and all you can drink, which was a pretty good deal if you drink a lot. I mean, I don't drink anymore, but back then I was making out pretty good. But going from that to get to stand on stage with Alice, it was kind of like, it was my rock star movie moment, you know, when they say, if you work hard enough and you want it bad enough, dreams come true. That was my moment like that. Like, you know, I feel like the guy in that movie, that I really am that proof here with you guys right now today that that can happen if you work hard enough and you want it bad enough. And if you pour that emotion into whatever it is you're doing, I think that is the most important part of the creative process. I know it's kind of a rambling answer as all the rest of them have been, but I hope that's helpful. There we go.
This might be the other side of that, but when you're on stage, mm-hmm. what would you say, like, what's the key to entertaining people? Or is it just switching your brain off and playing?
The key to entertaining people is to do something that they want to see. So we sort of started talking about it earlier, and I'll talk more about it now. I think the main thing is to get rid of the fear of making mistakes or feeling awkward. You know, I had a conversation with Tommy, one of our other guitar players, and he said, if you feel like you're being awkward, being weird, do it more. Because that's what, you know, like, whatever feels uncomfortable, if you feel like, oh, maybe I'm moving too big, move bigger. Whatever it is, because like I said earlier, if anybody wants to just hear how the record's played, they should just listen to the record at home. They come to see you, to see the show, to see something entertaining. I think it's also about making connections, like making one-on-one connections with people that are there. Josh calls me the baby champion because I always love finding kids in the crowd. I always will find, you know, because I love, you know, as a somewhat young guitar player, I like to see young guitar players, inspire young guitar players. So I will, you know, my thing is I'll always find kids in the crowd and try to really play to them and make it a fun show for them. I think about if I was 10 and I went to a show and I got a guitar pick and the guitar player gave me a high five, that would stick with me for the rest of my life. I would go home and get a guitar. Like, so that's the kind of connection I try to make with people. And I think that's the kind of thing, whether it's the kids or whether it's, you know, your peers or whatever it is, I think that's something that will make the show a lot better, finding people to connect with. And I have my little jokes I like to think about during the show. Sometimes, like, you know, some of the goofier Alice lyrics, like when he says in Cold Ethel, even if I live till 97, she'll still be waiting in refrigerator heaven. And I always find somebody that knows the word, like, refrigerator heaven? Like, what is refrigerator heaven? So finding common ground with people, even if it's somebody that you're never going to meet and never say a word to, finding that common ground with them can make the show, I think, astronomically better. I hope that helps. Yeah?
You know, it's funny, one of the last things I remember seeing on stage in Fillmore, at the Warfield, was you handing a pick to a girl who was on somebody's shoulders.
I remember that, because she was on her dad's shoulders. I totally remember this real young girl, and she was on her dad's shoulders, and she was doing the horns. Like, it was so freaking cute. And I was like, bring her up here. I'm going to give her a pick. And the dad was... I'm trying to think of a family-friendly word. The dad wasn't making the move. I was like, bring her up here.
The crowd wasn't moving much either.
No, they weren't helping him out, but he didn't, like, and I get it. They were in the middle-ish, like how it is here, and there were seats in front of them, so he couldn't come straight to me, like, as if it was a general admission show. But I was like, go around. Like, I'm trying to have a moment. Like, and he's like, so finally, like, I went and I was like, go around the seats, and then I went and, you know, high five some people over there, and by that time he had come around, and I did get my moment, but that was a funny thing. Like, and sometimes the parents are more enthusiastic than the kids, actually. Yeah. So I don't know, I don't have any explanation. Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
So I'm relatively new to guitar. I started about 9 months ago. Nice. But I've been into metal for a long time and excited to finally get started. But I had a question kind of at Google and the tech industry in general, the lack of gender diversity in women in the industry.
How did I know this was going to be that question?
it pairs up well. Is a big issue that's in discussion today. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could speak about your experience being in another male-dominated field as a female guitarist.
Absolutely.
Both good and bad.
And I would love to talk with you afterward about your experience in this industry, too.
Yeah, sure.
I find it so interesting, and I bet it's going to be really similar.
Yeah.
So where do I start with this one? What's it like being a female in heavy metal, right? Like the question. My short, funny answer is it's the same as being a guy in heavy metal, except I usually get my own bathroom. Except at the war field.
It's a perk.
It is a perk. The reality is, and I imagine if it's similar in tech, the reality is you'd have a harder road ahead of you. It's harder to be taken seriously. You can't just show up wearing whatever you want or saying whatever you want or doing whatever you want, because no matter what you wear or say or do, someone's gonna have something to say about it, and it's gonna be because you're a girl. It doesn't matter what it is. If I wear a baggy black t-shirt, like if I wear, you know, I went on a whole tour once where I wore baggy camo pants and baggy band shirt, Slayer shirt or whatever, and then I looked like a lesbian. You know, I don't dress sexy enough. And then I went on a tour, I was in Revolver Magazine, Hottest Chicks in Hard Rock or whatever that is. Then it's too sexy. Then it's, she's not a serious musician. You know, like, there's really not any way to get around what you're gonna face and what I face all the time. So the only thing that I can say to you that will make it better is be so good at what you do that nobody can say it's because of anything. Nobody can ever, you know, and I'm not even as good at what I do as I want to be, but nobody, and they will still say it, but nobody can truthfully say that the only reason I'm touring now is because I'm a girl and because I dress X, Y, and Z way, because I made sure that the playing left no doubt. And of course there are better guitar players. Of course there are going to be better programmers. There are going to be better, you know, better people in every industry. But if you work as hard as you can and make sure that, you know, you're on time, you're on point, you never have a bad day. Trust me. Never, ever have a bad day because then you're, we're a family friendly show, right?
Then
sure, you're a bitch forever. Sorry. But I mean, and it is, it's a tough double standard. It is, you know, if I have a bad show, I don't deserve the gig with Alice Cooper because I'm a girl. No one's, you know, if they go see a guy up there playing and the guy has a bad show, if he's distracted or tired or whatever it is, no one's gonna go, that guy just got the gig because he's sleeping with somebody in the band, you know, or whatever it is. It's an unfortunate double standard that that I'm not gonna lie to you about. And I don't think anybody should, you know, as much as we would all like to say, no, that doesn't happen, like everyone is equal now, like it is always gonna have that connotation. So the only thing I can really say is leave no doubt with what it is that you do. Make sure that your work ethic and your personal ethic and everything you can do is above reproach. So no one can be like, she's drunk all the time, you know, she's always late, she's always in a bad mood, you know, like, and if you have those qualities, if you have those higher qualities, then the girl thing will fade away. And it is starting to fade away for me, finally, after doing this for 20 million years. I'm 29 now. I started touring when I was 15. And it's now finally starting to get, you know, I'm starting to be on lists of guitar players that aren't lists of girl guitar players, which is nice. It's a hard road. I'm not gonna lie to you about it. Just be who you are and don't let anybody tell you you can't do it. That's the most important thing. It sounds like a cliche, but that's my best advice.
Yeah, thanks, that's great.
Absolutely.
So you talked in the beginning about being constantly on the road and back-to-back gigs and blah, blah, blah. I'm curious about, the war stories are cool, but mm-hmm. in a year of a touring musician, how much downtime is there? And what do you do for fun that doesn't involve a guitar?
I don't even know what downtime is. You know, I've been on this tour with Alice for 2.5 years. We get breaks from that tour, and on those breaks, I do guitar clinics for Ibanez. And so they'll send me out, usually by myself. You know, I just did 6 weeks in Europe alone, and I did a couple weeks in Canada by myself the year before that. And some places, you know, when I go someplace dangerous, we were in South America going to Colombia and stuff. Thankfully, they'll send Josh with me, so I'm not going by myself. But for the most part, I'm by myself. And it is really lonely. You don't think, you look at my tour schedule and you think, this is the coolest life ever. And it is the coolest life. I mean, like, I looked at my clinic tour schedule for Europe in February, and, you know, it was 6 weeks in a different country every single day. And I was like, this is awesome. But then you get out there and you're doing it, and you want to show somebody the picture, like, look at this cathedral, look at this thing, and you're by yourself for the majority of it. And so it makes the time at home so much more precious and valuable. And honestly, when I'm home, I mean, now I'm gonna have some real time at home, so I'm sure I'll pick up some hobbies. But aside from going to the gym, which is, you know, what I replaced drinking with, you know, aside from the gym, really, I just like being home. I like cooking. I even like doing laundry. Like, I probably won't like it after a month of being home, but that's really it. That's the downtime, hang out with the boyfriend and the dogs and the cat and just enjoy the time, because it goes too soon, it goes too fast.
Can you play a couple examples of stuff you love to play? Just a couple examples? Since you're all set.
Yeah, thanks, Andy.
we've got 1 minute left.
Well, we've got that backing track. You want to just run that and sure. Just see what I come up with? Because I haven't really been. Wait, hold on.
Okay.
Let's just run it. Let's just see what I come up with.
Okay.
Yeah.
It started.
Yeah, it will start. Can you turn it up at all?
Sure.
So there's a lot more string noise and harmonics.
Yeah, a lot more, because I'm the only one up. But I just want to say thank you guys so much for making me feel so welcome here. This has been one of the most fun clinics that I've ever done, and I've had a great time chatting with you guys. So thank you very much for coming. Thank you, Andy, very much for having me.
Thank you for coming.